Please take a time and move and meet each other. This is something I learned, that networking is very important. So I know all of you maybe came with your friends, but please take a time and introduce yourself to one each other and see what they are doing and what opportunities they have and why they are here. It's important. Today we have a very special guest with us here, Mr. Fernandez from Microsoft. He heads the Microsoft regional startup. We are very pleased to have him here. Thank you very much for accepting our invitation. We are really pleased to have a representative from major leading innovation companies in the world to share their ideas and their best practices and their insight on where is the startup topic in the Middle East and especially in the UAE. I'm also very pleased to introduce my friend, Thraya Turk. She is a lawyer and she has a Legal Circle law firm, one of our star tenants, I must say, and one of our leading star CEOs as well, female CEOs. So we are very pleased to have her here. We did this event in partnership with her firm, so she's a very big supporter of SRTIP. A quick word maybe about SRTIP. Sharjah Research and Technology Park is a government of Sharjah initiative to support and promote innovation, research, and venture building in the UAE and throughout the region. The purpose of this place is to foster relationship between academia, government, and private sector. We aim to create through this triple helix model a formula that will hopefully create new companies, create a new science and technology, and develop talent and scientists. That's the bottom line. We want to do three things. One, we want to develop talents and scientists. Two, we want to develop intellectual property and science and technology. And three, we want to leverage science and IP to create companies that will create, inshallah, economic impact and develop our GDP and develop our economies and develop and provide jobs and opportunities for everyone. So the park, thanks God, we moved here around October. It has fascinating facilities. Probably you went around and saw what we have here. We are very blessed to have His Highness the ruler of Sharjah as a chair of this organization, as a big supporter of this organization. And we all know, as a visionary leader, we can only expect not less than this from him. He is the bigger endorser of this project, and of course the whole university city. We pride ourselves to have today one of the biggest university cities in the Middle East. We have 22 university and education institutions just next door, more than 45,000 students, 2,000 PhDs, all in one place. So it's our duty here to really work with this ecosystem to create innovation. So today's session is one of the initiatives we wanted to launch to really foster and promote innovation and hopefully bring innovation closer to you and also bring you closer to the innovation. I will stop here and I would like to ask my colleague Thraya to maybe say a few things about her and her company and then maybe introduce our special guest. Again, thank you very much for being here. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Hussein, and thank you all for coming tonight. I understand it's cold and we have to sit out, but it's such a beautiful night, so hopefully we can enjoy this discussion with Mr. Robert and His Excellency Hussein. So once again, thank you. My name is Thraya Turk and I'm the Managing Partner of Legal Circle. We are, in fact, incorporated at this very park. And one of the reasons when we set up the company, we were deciding where to go. We wanted to be strategically advantageous and competitive in a market where it's quite small, and it's quite small, but there's a rich ecosystem. And you know, one of the things that we were thinking about when we wanted to support our clients is be where they are. Where is the next wave of technology? Where is the next wave of innovation? Where is the next wave of talent coming from? And we want to be there to support them. So it was just a no-brainer after meeting Mr. Hussein and understanding what his vision of the park was going to be that we would set up in the park itself. And alhamdulillah, today it's working absolutely fantastically. and we can join together our forces to bring to you these events where we can engage with each other, learn from each other, hopefully inspire each other, and produce positive results. So a little bit about what we do. We practice all areas of law. In particular, what we're very interested in is nurturing startups, supporting them throughout their entrepreneurial journey. So from the very concept stage, developing their idea all the way through to execution, incorporating a company, and then of course fundraising and growth stage to the exit stage. So some of you in the audience already know who I am because most likely we are supporting you. For those who don't, perhaps we can reach out at a later stage and we can talk more, because tonight is not about me by any means. Tonight is about Robert, and Mr. Hussein and the wonderful work that they're doing. And our focus will be to speak to Robert, who comes from Microsoft, from startup, to see what is Microsoft doing globally, what are they doing regionally, and what are they doing very locally in the UAE that makes them so good. Microsoft is a name that everybody knows, and they're so influential in the tech space, and particularly Robert heads the Microsoft for Startups. So we'll hear a lot more about that today. And of course, Hussein will tell us about Sharjah Research Technology, what the vision is. Hussein's a man of a vision, so there's lots of ideas that he has, and we'll hear more about those today. And then we'll open up the floor for people's questions. So without further ado, let me take a seat and moderate the conversation. Thank you. All right, so I might just start with Mr. Robert from Microsoft. So we've already, you know, said who you are and where you're from, but can you tell us a little bit about Microsoft globally? So what they do, what your position is in within the global perspective of Microsoft, and then we'll take it to the UAE. Yeah, let's start from there.
Cool. Perfect. Okay. So first of all, allow me to thank you for having me today. It's an honor, and I love the setting, and I love the energy. I love the fact that we are in this symbolic place as well to discuss about this topic, which is very important. So as you're saying, Microsoft is a big organization, right? So it all at global level, let's say, as Microsoft is an organization, it all starts from the mission that Microsoft has. And the mission of
I think maybe you can use this, probably this is better one.
It's better, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Is okay? Yeah.
Yeah.
So it all starts with the mission, right? So the mission of Microsoft is to empower every person and organization in the world to achieve more. And that translates into different things, because, for example, myself, I'm looking after startups, and that mission means to me empower every single founder and startup in the ecosystem, in the region I'm dealing with to achieve more, right? That mission drives a lot of the things that happens at Microsoft at the global level, and it's a source of inspiration for employees to really try to impact the life of millions of people. And I have a little anecdote here, because when I decided to make this move, I joined Microsoft a year and a half ago now. A very special friend now, and he's part of the ecosystem here in the UAE, he reached out to me, and this, you know, we were discussing, and he knew about this role, and he told me, "I'm very jealous. You know, you're going to get a very nice role, and because you can have a lot of impact." And I say, "Yeah, I mean, it's a great role. I love it, and thank you for." And then he said, "You know, in this role, you can even save lives." And at the beginning, I thought, "Well, it feels a little bit, you know, too much. I mean, and it's not like I'm going to save lives." But then, think about entrepreneurship in this region, in the region that you are on, broadly speaking.
And I'm just, sorry, I think can you hear me? It's very low. Maybe I think you can maybe bring the mic a little bit closer to you.
Yeah, I can.
Yeah, because I think the mic.
I can keep it like that.
This is perfect.
Okay, yes. Yeah, it was not.
Yeah. Maybe you want to put that down. Yeah, perfect.
It's all three's fault.
Yeah.
That was my fault.
No, so I was saying, so it was saying, think about what entrepreneurship means for this region, right? So back to global, Microsoft mission empowers all of this.
And if I may ask, I'm sorry, but I if you can talk a little bit slowly, because I know the English is not Okay. The best format, so just for people to get also
sure.
All the concept that you are trying to communicate.
No problem.
Thank you.
Absolutely. So at the global level, Microsoft mission when it comes to entrepreneurship is that of empowering startups to grow and scale. The concept behind is to provide value beyond just pure technology. Of course, every technology player wants to have more companies, more business building on their technology. But the real mission there is to provide value to startups. And the value from a Microsoft perspective comes from the fact that Microsoft has a worldwide presence. Microsoft works with a lot of corporates around the world. So the focus is for us at a global scale to connect in a meaningful way startups to corporates. So give access to enterprise solutions, B2B startups to corporates, and by doing that accelerate their sales, and by doing that bring also innovation to corporates. So build a sort of an ecosystem where both sides, startups and corporates, can co-create and collaborate together. This is at a global level, so allowing also startups to access to markets where they don't necessarily have a presence and scale globally.
And so can you tell us a little bit about those startups, what industries they're in? Do you have a particular focus and a mandate on specific startups within industries, or is it just startups generally, more generally, of course, in the context of Microsoft?
Sure. In the context of Microsoft and globally, we do have some industries where we are more focused, but in general, we aim at having technology empowering everyone, every single, so we are agnostic, if you want, in terms of specific industries or verticals, even if there is, you know, there are some industries where by the fact that Microsoft has more clients or more value proposition to offer, because there are specific solutions. I'm thinking about, now we're talking a lot about agri-tech. And Microsoft developed this solution called FarmBits, which is hosted on the cloud to collect data from different partners and allow agri-tech solutions to tap into this data and then build on top of that without reinventing the wheel. Same thing in other industries like financial services, like retail, so there are healthcare. So there are industries where there is more that Microsoft can offer because there is a strong value proposition behind. But we think that we need to build products for everyone, and technology should be for everyone. So we are trying to democratize and give access to technology to every single business or industry in the world.
Okay. Amazing.
So if I may, I would like to go maybe one step back. And where is Microsoft today in the technology scene? What are the key areas of focus for Microsoft today? Globally, and then maybe again, when it comes to the context of UAE or maybe the Middle East, what are the strategy of Microsoft?
Sure. So the strategy is definitely since Satya moved on and became CEO a few years ago, it definitely refocused and positioned the company more in the cloud, right? So definitely the whole adoption of the cloud and enabling businesses to build on the cloud is definitely a priority for the company globally and regionally. And I would say the investment Microsoft did in the UAE with local data centers, for example, is really important for this country, right? So, because it enables a lot of organizations and businesses, especially in regulated industries, to build locally, to be compliant with the laws, to have data hosted locally, so to build their business in a good way. So cloud is definitely a priority. But also there are other areas in the business that are definitely interesting if you think about the future of work, so remote work and collaboration tools. If you think about modern workplace, so all those solutions with Microsoft 365 to allow people to collaborate and work together and share information. And if you think about also data and analytics, the whole suite of Power Platform, Power BI, all those solutions that enable new businesses, small businesses, corporates or enterprises to build applications and also to analyze data and build solutions and applications on top of the data.
Yeah, so I was going to say that's traditionally how we know Microsoft, right? So when you talk about Microsoft, we do think about the cloud. But you're in a very particular and I think a very special department within Microsoft. That's Microsoft for Startups. And I understand they're doing similar but different things across the globe. But in the UAE, Microsoft for Startup is really your baby. So can you just tell us about what you're doing with Microsoft Startup, what your vision is, how it's similar but different to what they're doing across the globe, and why you've done it in the UAE? Why did you choose UAE to set up Microsoft for Startups?
Yeah, absolutely. Look, on one hand, we are aligned with a global team, right? Because we are part of a global team, which is Microsoft for Startups globally. And of course, we have programs that apply globally. And the reality is those programs are largely geared towards later stage startups, which we do have also in this part of the world, but not as many as in other ecosystems that invested into building their ecosystems early on. So what we are going to do here is Microsoft for Startups in this region will definitely align the startups that fit the criteria for the global program on one hand, but on the other hand, what we did is developing a strategy that makes sense for this ecosystem to try and have an impact on this ecosystem. The ecosystem here is still earlier stage. So we are launching a series of programs that are geared towards, first of all, startups that are a few steps before startups that would qualify for our global program. So the aim there is to take them into a journey, hands-on, where we can take them to that level. So we can help startups either grow revenue, so build the right business model, understand how to go to market, understand how to get clients, and so on and so forth, while building on technology, so building on the right architecture, building products that people are going to use and can scale. And on the other hand, we are trying to help them get to funding, right? Because at the end of the day, that's the engine that will fuel the next wave of growth for them. On top of that, we also have programs where we are launching programs that will tap even earlier on. So we're looking at youth in particular as the key engine of the transformation that we envision or we wish to happen from here, from UAE. Why UAE? UAE is a fantastic place across the region because of how government is involved with entrepreneurship, how government can make decisions kind of quickly and change things, so can inspire and can, you know, play the leader within the ecosystem where other governments can follow and see, you know, lead by example. And also Microsoft has been investing, as we said before, in this region with local data centers. So there is a nice a combination of positive factors there that allow us to, you know, push hard on this agenda in the UAE. And UAE can definitely become a hub, a regional hub, in between different regions, not just the Middle East, but at the cross with Africa and other Europe and the other regions, right? So, and there will be more incentives and more laws that will be approved in the coming months to make it easier for entrepreneurs and founders to develop that. For me, it's important having programs and spending effort and time as well focusing on youth, because it's also a matter of changing the mindset. Because if you ask me, if I look ahead and have a vision of this place becoming a regional hub and definitely having what it takes to get there, but the reality is we are also starting behind, right, compared globally to other ecosystems. And that has to do also with the mindset of not having only businesses here that are copycat of businesses that proved already elsewhere, which is great, it's important to have localization, right? But it's also start exporting from here new concepts, new ideas, new business models, new products. So thinking about, you know, the ambition should be solving real problems. So that should be the real focus that I want to see in the next wave of founders, entrepreneurs in this region. Focusing on real problems, and then identifying and developing products and solutions that can solve for that, because that is what enables then the business to scale and to have impact on the millions of lives and people.
Sure. So I have a practical question. Let's say I'm a company and data analysis or VR mixed reality, or in practical terms, how can I benefit from Microsoft Startups program? impactful? What can I benefit? How can I become part of it and leverage that?
Absolutely. So there are different ways depending on the maturity of the startups and the stage the startup is at. So if the startup, if you're talking about startups that are already, they already solved the product market fit, right? So they already have a product that they validated and they validated that a market exists for that product. These are kind of later stage startups. These startups might be a fit for what I said before is our global program. So if they meet those criteria, we can onboard them into the global program and we have a set of resources available to help them build the product to scale.
Because they will have to pay to be part of the program?
No. We don't take equity. There is, you know, we don't take equity and there is nothing to pay. Actually, on there are two sides always on our programs. One is the access to technology. So what we do is usually we include credits for building on the cloud and licenses for other products that Microsoft has, but also mentorship and support in terms of reviewing the architecture of the product, building the product, think about scalability, cost optimization, integration with third-party applications, for example, that are all on the technology side. On the go-to-market, we have a journey where for enterprise solutions, we take them onto a marketplace. So basically the aim there, the goal there is to move those solutions from being market ready, because we're talking about in this case, product market fit done, market ready solutions, but to become enterprise ready. And that requires a lot of effort, it's a journey. So we take the startups on that journey by helping them publish their solution on our marketplace, helping them with pricing strategy, go to market, how to pivot their model if it's just a B2B marketplace into a SaaS solution, software as a service solution, for example. And then becoming transactable. That means in a region like this, where we think that MENA at large is one region, but in reality it is not, because if you are a fintech, for example, today, and there are already different regulations only in the UAE, and you want to scale in MENA, it's a hard job for an entrepreneur to achieve that. So by becoming transactable in the marketplace, basically we give access to markets where startups and founders don't necessarily have a presence, but we can take care of the transaction so they can get business done faster and they can get to a better valuation, a better round of funding faster. And then for the startups that get through this journey, the ultimate goal is to make them partners to Microsoft. If they achieve that late stage, if you want, basically we will be able to unlock an even broader involvement of Microsoft, because basically they will become partners where our teams on the ground will be able to sell that IP, those solutions, to their corporates. And the reason behind this is that Microsoft is involved and exposed daily to conversation with clients on digital transformation. And so there is a lot of knowledge there about what are the use cases, the challenges, the scenarios where these corporates are facing and where they are stuck. And it's not just by selling Microsoft products that those challenges will be solved, right? You need a real solution. So and most of the times you can see that startups might have already solved for those use cases. So the thinking behind is, if we build an ecosystem where we can bring startups that have built for those use cases or for those solutions to corporates to help them in their innovation journey, while giving business to startups and while having this ecosystem building on Microsoft, there is a win-win-win kind of circle that is beneficial for everyone, because there is more innovation happening and there is more development of startups happening, more jobs created, sure, and so on and so forth. This is for startups that are post-product market fit, and this is how we would work with them, by tapping them into a global program that we are executing, of course, from here. For startups that are a few steps earlier, what we are going to do is, in the coming months, we already announced that a couple of weeks back in January, we are going to launch an accelerator, virtual accelerator, that will be geared towards enterprise solutions, but earlier stage. So we don't have the same criteria, of course, of the global program. There will be it will be startups that are not necessarily backed by institutional funding and not necessarily generating, you know, crazy amounts of revenues, because the purpose will be exactly to take them through the journey to increase or to understand how to make, to tweak that business model, to make more revenues or to get funded. So this accelerator will kick off the first cohort around the end of August. And we are putting in place all the necessary steps to to have a competition at some point in the next months and then select the startups. We will have two cohorts per year of 15 startups each, and we will have a scalable model to add expansion partners on top to fund additional cohorts if needed. Longer term, we are, as I said before, we are also looking at youth. So we are finalizing the plan for a program that will touch youth to share with them the experience of what entrepreneurship really is as a mindset, and start there, and then create a sort of a funnel. So the project is really ambitious. I cannot share more at this stage about that, but it will be really ambitious in terms of the impact we aim to have across the whole region. And from there, we want to create a funnel from students that are touched into ideas, into incubation, acceleration, and so on and so forth.
I want to ask you a question. Okay. So I think I want to ask you a question, and then I think we will take a break and maybe allow the audience to ask questions so they don't get bored as well. So those programs, I'm very sure a lot of people are not aware about it, from the people here or the startup in general, and I think that's an opportunity for a country like UAE to become a hub for major international companies. These are big opportunities for the business community to really tap into the opportunities. But I would ask you, Sri, as a business owner and kind of also a startup, were you aware of what a company like Microsoft is doing or other companies, and have you ever participated in some of their programs, and if yes, what, and if not, why, and how do you think such programs can help you as a business?
Okay, so I guess the starting point is with a accelerator program like Microsoft, what they're really looking at is, although they're sector agnostic, they're looking at what companies and startups have something that can actually scale and grow. So our business is a little bit different in the sense that we provide more services, and until we have a platform or a technology that's supporting what we do, it wouldn't be seen by say Microsoft or one of the other sort of tech players as being something that's scalable. So personally, for example, in our business, I wouldn't approach Microsoft until I was ready to launch our platform, which we've spoken about before, where we can automate and generate, say, documents. Or, for example, we have a platform where people can ask us questions that they get automatic answers to. So until we have a technology which can actually scale what we do, then I would, approach Microsoft and some of the other accelerator programs that are out there. But how did I hear about Microsoft? Well, essentially, most of the startups that we support are in technology. So for us, when we see something that is scalable, we will go out to the region and say, what is in the ecosystem? What is available out there to support our startups to get ahead? So how can they participate in these accelerators? So for example, we have a number of fintech clients, and we know, for example, within the DIFC, they've got fintech hives, and they've got a few other accelerator programs, so that would be a perfect fit for them. And then what we do is we make that introduction for them. So fintech, you would go to the ecosystem that's developed, and it's very well developed both in the ADGM and the DIFC. If, for example, we had another client with a different type of technology, it could be like an e-commerce platform, for example, or it could be, say, in ag tech or ed tech, most of the times I will say to them, we'll go to Sharjah Innovation Technology Park, because, again, Sharjah Innovation Technology Park is providing an ecosystem for those players. So I think as a startup, if you're moving into that space and you're just becoming an entrepreneur, the question you have to ask yourself is, where do I want to be and why? At the moment, UAE has become saturated with free zones, saturated with accelerator programs, saturated for good reason. They are trying to develop an ecosystem, but not every opportunity out there will be the right fit for you. So it's a question of, what do you want, why do you want it, and how will that help you develop in the industry that you're in? So that's the key question, okay. I think, when you're trying to find an ecosystem to place yourself, it's to say, what am I doing, and who's going to support me to get there fastest? When you're in technology, though, it is all about scalability. It is all about your product, it is about refining it, and then it is about scaling it. Because when you're looking for an investor, and you probably know this already, and Sharjah Park knows this through their angel investors, The first question for an investor who's going to be investing in you as a company, a startup, or a technology is, what will the return be? How can we scale your product? How do we scale it so that it becomes profitable, so that we either list this or we sell and make a lot of money? And this is ultimately, from an investor's perspective, what they're looking for.
Yep. Just to build on what you were saying, so that's one thing. So that's why I'm saying the focus before the where, which is, of course, I agree with you, in the ecosystem you need to answer that question, is also the first question is, what problem me as an entrepreneur, as a founder, and is it a real problem or is it a symptom, right? So this is one thing. The second point you mentioned is on the ecosystem is spot on. This is what we really need. Is an ecosystem, and because the ecosystem comes with abundance of ideas, you need to have more ideas, more startups as an enabling factor. And what makes an ecosystem evolve is there are different drivers, but definitely the ecosystem should have a degree of local and global connectedness, that where people are coming together with diversity not just of gender, but of experiences of different disciplines that you present, for example, over here, that come together to share and support each other. So when people in the organization look at startups not to get from them, but to help them, that is what we need to ignite to make the ecosystem happen. And this is what we are trying to do. For example, working with government and corporates to surface what are the challenges that either the UAE as a country, as a nation, wants to invest on, or the corporates really have, so that when we work with founders and startups, we can push those solutions and those startups that will have a market and will are working on the right direction. R&D is important. There are other ecosystems where they know already now for the next 3 years that they want to invest in, I don't know, cybersecurity, and that they will have a shortage in terms of skills of 3,000 engineers 3 years from now. And they're already investing in bootcamps to create those skills and talents ahead of time. So this is what I wish we build more of this here, attracting students here with new visas, new regulations, and attracting diversity of thinking as well. Because at the cross of that diversity of ideas is where magic happens, right? So the ecosystem play is really key to enable entrepreneurs and ideas to flourish and to happen. And then at some point, you also need to see the maturity of the startups, availability of early stage funding as well to make sure this is sustainable. But we see that the maturity is growing in this ecosystem. Of course, that's why I always keep the ambition very high. We should think about we should stop thinking about just copying or business models that are just purely services or I think the mindset, that's why I touch base of starting from youth and where the mindset is different. So maybe it's also there are nuances in the culture about when we hear about you should fail fast, right? And maybe it's not really part of the culture about fear, because there is a concept of reputation, there is a concept of what people would think about me if I fail. But think about it, most of the most successful entrepreneurs are not first-time entrepreneurs. So it means that they went through other experiences, they've been there, they've been through the ups and downs and so on and so forth. So we need to have an ecosystem that allows failure. There is this anecdote. I was in this interview with a great founder of a startup, and he was asked, why have you been successful in your life, in your startup venture? And he replied, that's easy, two words, right decisions. And I say, wow, that sounds pretty easy, in fact, but how have you been able to make the right decisions? And he said, oh, that's another easy question. It's just one word this time, is experience. And I say, well, it seems like you are very much simplifying the thing. And how did you get then the experience to make the right decision? And he said, another easy answer from you. Two words again, wrong decisions. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it's true. We need to build an environment where even if you're successful, when you build your product, you can fail fast and iterate. Or when you really fail, you don't need to hold your passport across to you because you need to, fly away. I mean, or it's not costing you more than the cost of opening a business. So we need to build an ecosystem where, because you have to go through that journey as an entrepreneur, and you need to understand it's not easy. There will be ups and downs. So that's something that needs to happen. The sooner, the better for this ecosystem to thrive and really raise also the ambition of thinking about building products from here that can scale and export technology from here.
Thank you. I'd like to maybe allow the audience to ask questions. So at least we have more interaction. Anyone have any questions so far? Any burning questions? No questions?
Oh, there's one there.
Well, okay.
Has anybody got the mic?
Yeah. We'll give you a mic, Kelly. If you can allow yourself as well.
Sure. Can you hear me? Yeah, I think so. My name is Haneen Hazim. I was born in the UAE, and I graduated from the American University of Sharjah. I'm pretty much very interested in entrepreneurship because I started my own companies when I was 17 years old. And you really touched a very deep, I wouldn't say a pain, but a deep thing when you said fail fast, because I did fail, of course, with my first company, and it was a journey. But my question that I wanted to ask you, Roberto, is that why is there any specific reason why you started with a B2B kind of accelerators? I mean, startups that are focusing on B2B rather than B2C or even B2G, which is governments, business to governments. I'm just interested to know because I found it a little bit more enjoyable to interact with consumers a little bit more than enterprises or companies.
Yep, that's a great question. Thank you for asking. There is a specific reason, and it connects back to the value proposition that Microsoft can bring to the table. A few years back, Microsoft was having a different program for startups, which was made about giving out credits, you know, to have startups building on the cloud, and that was mainly it. And as you know, there are many other cloud vendors that are doing the same. So what was happening is that startups and founders, especially early stage, where you still have, let's not forget it, we still have 95% of, you know, rate of startups that are failing. You were spreading credits around, and then when the credits ended or expired, the founders were going to another cloud provider, got the credits for another year, and then to another cloud provider, got the credits for another year. So when Satan went to CEO, he wanted to review the programs for startups, he asked it to focus on something that can bring really value to startups beyond the credits. And honestly, if you ask me, and I've been in other tech companies before, if you ask me if I'm a tech startup and I limit myself thinking that technology is a pure cost in the P&L, there's something wrong somewhere, right? Because technology should allow me in the step to scale, but at the right time, of course. I need to prove to do the product market fit and go through that journey. So the thinking has been, if we are restarting a program for startups from scratch, instead of going into an insane competition with other cloud vendors that you all know, just to offer more credits, it feels like you're offering kilograms of data somewhere to us, right? So why don't we focus instead of added value we can really bring? So that's why the thinking has been, okay, let's not be the same thing to everyone. Where we can connect in a meaningful way, where should we start? And the thinking was, let's start from B2B solutions. Why? Because there is this value proposition I was saying before, where a B2B solution would plug into this journey where we can really help a B2B get on a marketplace, get more clients, become more enterprise ready on the go-to-market, this cross-sell motion. So there is a real value. Think about it. It's true. On a global scale, we passed the $1 billion in pipeline revenues for startups that became cross-sell ready in the program. And that's real value for a founder. If you ask a founder, where do you need help? Most of the times they would tell you, yeah, access to capital, okay, and then you should have a long conversation because you should get capital at the right time to scale, right? Not in general, and also give me clients access to revenues, to increase my revenues, right? So this is easy to say. When we hear about access to markets, having introductions or doors opening is a great starting point, but the journey to close deals and have revenues is long, right? So by having the right partner on board, or the right partnership model on board, you can accelerate that. So in short, the reason why we are focused globally on B2B is because there is a value proposition. And on the B2C side, I agree with you. I also, if you ask me, I love more B2C than B2B, also from my previous experience. But on the B2C side, I'm not saying we will not have offering or programs in the future, but definitely we want to nail down a value proposition that goes beyond credit, the same way we started doing with B2B startups. By the way, we are working with B2C startups as well, because there are B2Cs that want to build on Microsoft technology, they like the brand, and we are helping them. It's just that they might not be plugging into the additional value proposition we extend to B2B. That's why the focus is mainly on B2B.
Okay. There's a question here?
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah.
Hello?
Hi, good evening, everyone. Thanks, Mr. Hussein, for the talk. And Suraya, thanks for this gathering. It's amazing. Roberto, we met before, and thanks for all the support you gave for startups. My question is very specific regarding, we are in the VR and education. So from your perspective, what the present or opportunity for the virtual reality and mixed reality, especially education sector with Microsoft? Are you planning something very specific, especially with this kind of Microsoft Teams and how it works and this kind of empowering education everywhere? So yeah, please.
Yeah, that's a wonderful question. Thank you for asking. It's a great question. So I think, and we've seen it, we were commenting before about the pandemic, and I don't know how many of you have kids, but you know, me as a parent, having you know experienced that firsthand, I've seen the experience is far than optimal today, right? Because most educational institutions reacted to the situation, and they just moved part of the curriculum online, but that's not the experience. And honestly, the experience is today still very poor, and it's a nightmare for parents too. So that's not what it is, right? So for me, there is one thing that is common to a lot of different industries, and one thing that is specific to education. So the thing that is common to all the industry is that I wish that we have here founders, entrepreneurs that are thinking that disrupting an industry is a consequence of disrupting a customer or a user experience. So that should come first, in my opinion. Because we talk, what are the industries that we are going to be disrupted, but what does that mean? If you ask me, for example, years from now, I don't think insurance will still be a separate industry, because it might be embedded into whatever else, and you wouldn't even see it, right? So it will be maybe on demand and something like that. I don't know. But to me, the focus should be disrupting the experience. So that means back to first basic principles is understanding users in their circumstances, understanding what is that they are doing, why they have that need, with who, when, and understanding really the experience itself. So the focus should be on more on the experience. The other thing you mentioned, definitely, education is really key, because you see, it's not, I would see, first of all, it's clear it's going to be a lifelong learning, so we should forget that education stops with, you know, a certificate. But at the same time, you know, what is happening has shown that at different stages in your life, you need this education. Think about all the people that have been impacted by this situation, that now have lost maybe their job, or they are on hold, and they don't necessarily have the skills to recycle or to re-enter into the market, right, for example. So what is that we can do for them? Most of the startups in EdTech that I've been working on are thinking about predicting based on the history of the student with the school, but then what about the future, you know, what about the serendipity of things, or what about the purpose and mission, and what about the world is changing, and what about many other things, right? So the thinking sometimes, what I see, is still focused on responding or reacting rather than reimagining the future. And I think right now we should have come to a stage where we understand that this thing, this pandemic, is here with us, and we should, you know, coexist and live with it, but we should just think ahead and reimagine this future. Virtual reality with Teams, but only beyond Teams, with HoloLens. So the technology is there, but the technology is a means to an end. Is again, when it comes to technology, what is the real pain? What is the real problem with technology? And at scale, there are also parts of the world where there are less advantages still, and the access to is very difficult. I've seen solutions that are still using feature phones and trying to do education through SMS. Imagine that mother with 10 kids and trying to get them through SMS, right? Because it. So I think you know, the answer to your question is technology is there. There are beautiful solutions there. For me, it's more, what is the experience that you want to bring? First of all, what problem you are trying to solve when we talk about education? Because virtual reality, sometimes I hear also AI, right? So I see a lot of pitches of startups that, by the way, this is powered by AI. Okay, what does it mean? Because most of the times, so honestly, you don't need AI for the solutions that have been presented, right? So you don't have enough data to do a modeling on top of that, so it didn't make sense. So I would say, forget about the sexy part of adding VR or AI, or let's start from the basics and reimagine the experience, the future, what is the real problem. In education, definitely there are definitely a lot of problems there. Whether it's for empowering the next generation of the Gen Z, or Alpha is now, to the skills that are needed in today's world. If you think about, all the curriculums are still built on, came out of a different era, right? The industrial age and so on and so forth. So are we preparing the next generation of our future, the youth, for the way we're going to work and what we need for the years ahead, and I will build from there.
Thank you.
I actually just wanted to add to that. So we get a lot of clients all the time saying, you know, we want to get invested. So when they have a company, they think they've got a really good idea, they've got a technology, and now is the time that they want to grow it. So they're always looking for investors, yeah. And so anytime we go to a VC or an angel investor or anybody who's potentially can invest, that investor, the first question is, how are you solving a problem with a novel solution? They don't want to see technology for the sake of technology. Just because there's a race for technology and innovation, it doesn't mean that you can take an ordinary concept, build in a technology, and say, now I'm going to get an investor. It doesn't work like that, because technology is not you. As he said, you said it perfectly, that technology is just a tool. How are you using that technology that already exists and is already out there, and solving a problem, but it's a novel solution? How are you just disrupting? It's not about responding, it's not about reacting, it's not about saying, but mine does something a little bit different. How different is it? How unique is it? How novel is it? Because that's what's worth investing in. It's that idea that's different. It's the technology that's so disruptive that you can never go on anymore and do things the way you did them ordinarily. And this is, I think this is what, you know, particularly entrepreneurs who are going into technology always need to think about. Am I just using like VR for the sake of using VR, now making education, you know, sexy? Or am I now using AI in a law firm because, you know, now I don't have to have junior staff, AI pushes out answers? They did that 30, 40 years ago, you know? It was just not such a big deal then. Now it's a big deal. But now more than ever, it's about, how are you using that technology, taking it to the next level to find such a novel solution to a problem nobody else found? And then that's where you attract investors. That's where you, for example, become very interesting for Microsoft and the likes of, you know, Microsoft and other accelerators, because now you're onto something that was not there, you know, or used before in the way that you're using it. And I think this is what startups and entrepreneurs have to constantly ask themselves, you know, how am I using the technology and disrupting with it in a way that nobody else is? So do your research, do your groundwork, go out and see who's in the market, who's doing up. Even look globally, because as you were saying before,
You know, there's somebody else in the world that may have done it, or globally and locally we have to connect so that there's that dialogue, there's the open communication, there's the flourishing of ideas. So you can take what maybe something already exists, but take it to the next level that that person didn't envision it. And I think that's what, as a startup and entrepreneur, you need to do, you know?
Yeah, totally agree. And sometimes is innovation and entrepreneurship is not necessarily about the breakthrough, right? So you might be the one that comes with, you know, being the first one developing something nobody ever thought of. Okay, fair enough, that's awesome. But sometimes, actually, it's the opposite. If there is no one else building that thing already, chances are, given that there is a lot of smart people around in the world, chances are that's not maybe a good place to be in, because, you know, there is a lot of people with great talent and ideas, and most of them might have been thinking about the same problem, right? So the fact that the space is crowded, there is someone else, actually is a good indicator. It's not a bad indicator. And sometimes you say, oh, no, we need to find the, you know, the blue ocean where we have the first one. Yes, true, if you find that, go ahead, but that's really difficult, right? So it's incremental innovation as well is really important. So what you're saying is, I agree with that, is spot on. And again, it's a matter of mindset, and again, it's a matter of, when you said you can look around, it's a matter of getting out of the building and spending time with people. And you started the conversation this evening talking about networking. This is important. And for entrepreneurs, for founders, and for the ecosystem here, you need to be proactive in building your support network. Because what you need is a support network. It's like you yourself, your own startup, and you need to have your board of advisors, right? So, but those advisors won't come to you. You need to be proactive in building that. And doing that is not just connecting people randomly or attending an event and hoping that something happens. It's doing that with a purpose. So it's about giving something back before expecting to take something. And that's where I expect the ecosystem to evolve here, to allow more and more of this giving and back to happen, because that support network is what will sustain founders, entrepreneurs, ideas to flourish and to build on that. So, this is awesome.
Perfect. So please make sure that you have a target of meeting three new people tonight. So you work out with the new connections. We are almost out of time. We have 9 minutes to go. Any other questions? Okay, go ahead.
Hi, good evening. Thank you for sharing insights, Hussein, Soraya, Roberto. Really quick on me, I'm Devesh. I'm the co-founder of a digital coaching platform that's basically aiming to democratize access to coaching for organizations here targeting the MENA region. And I have a question with regards to access to corporates, right? Now, when we look at the West, and you look at what procurement structures they have, what sourcing structures they have, they're pretty startup friendly. Or not as startup friendly, but I think they're probably leading in that aspect. When we look at the Middle East here, they're not entirely startup friendly, particularly for enterprise solutions. Not just startup, whose target market are these enterprises. It does become a challenge to access them, even if you know that you are for the right solution and they agree with it. So for example, when we went through a procurement, they wanted X years of incorporation, X thousands of dollars of revenue already achieved before they could think about proceeding with companies like ours. So what is, you know, Legal Circle or your Microsoft startups doing in having these conversations with corporates, ensuring that they are startup friendly and so they're able to build a right ecosystem here within the region?
Go ahead just really quickly, and then I believe Roberta has a lot more to say on that topic. But so essentially what we would do, so if you were to approach me and you were to ask exactly that, what you're trying to do is tap into a market that is hard to get into, because as you said, corporates have an expectation already of who can be allowed into their space and who they're able to support and who they're able to do business with. So the key thing as a startup, as I was saying earlier, is to find an ecosystem that you can embed yourself in that you know has the support network behind it. So Microsoft, for example, what they're doing is a perfect
a perfect initiative and a program, because what they're essentially doing is allowing then startups like yourself to develop and grow in the areas that they need to, and then connect them to the corporate. So already that barrier is down for you. You don't need to do much work. Microsoft is a corporate. They're already speaking on a corporate level to others. By being in that ecosystem or accelerator program, now you can, you know, become involved, and they will push you essentially. So in this region in particular, more so than anywhere, it's a small place. And it is all about networking, and it is all about saying, where is the right fit for me, getting into that, and then trying to push down those walls. Because on your own, it's very hard to do. And that's globally, but more so here in the UAE as well. So finding out the right programs, right accelerators, right ecosystems, and being part of them, that will automatically open doors for you to start connecting. And that's the best way to do it with corporates. And of course, you probably have more time to it.
No, spot on. I totally agree. The startup corporate is a very interesting conversation, because usually people associate startups to unicorns or agile companies, and corporates to dinosaurs, elephants, or you know, things that are not moving anymore. So, and then that's partially true, but at the same time, let's not forget that corporate sits on reserve of cash that are higher than what venture capitalists have. So if they were able to deploy that money more intelligently, I mean, they have the business, right? So they have the customers, so, and they have needs, because they are stuck sometimes with innovation. So that is very interesting. Now, I agree with you. So most of the times I hear this conversation, most of the times it boils down to the finding startups and then matchmaking with corporates, right? So, and honestly, is that the real issue? Not really, because you have plenty of ideas, especially, you know, now you can source idea startups globally. And matchmaking is not a difficult part. The difficult part is, as you are saying, is when you start working with the corporate, because you have, the problem is culture. So startups come with a culture where you get things done, and you get things done no matter what, you wrap your sleeves and you're agile, you just get things done, right? And corporates comes with this, let's say in a polite way, this alignment that they build around to sustain the core business, right? And that's needed, because they've been successful. But then the two cultures usually comes to a clash. So there is one thing is culture. Second thing definitely is the processes. So procurement, but it's not the only one. We've seen, for example, startups failing working with corporates because they didn't do the homework of understanding if they could have got access to the right data. You think, oh, this is straightforward. Why a corporate would work with a startup if they don't give them access to the data that they need? But it's not that straightforward. In fact, many times this doesn't work. And if the startup didn't secure that access, how they could get to develop something meaningful for the customer of the corporate, right? And this is just one other example. So the long story short, I think, is that, programs like ours are good in that direction, because we are trying, definitely bridging the gaps between enterprise solutions and corporates, connecting with corporates, working to close deals, and so on and so forth. So this is great. Still, the problem of having the corporate really adopting the solution and using it, is a different challenge as well, because I've been in sales before a long time, and you know, one thing is selling the product, one thing is having the client to sell the product to really use it. And sometimes I sell the product and you know, the client was not really using it. And I was joking with my teams and say, we should make it physical product. So like, you know, the whole, because then if you see it, they say, okay, we purchased this, we put money, we remember that we have it. But you know, it's the reality of things is that this is what happens within many of the corporations of large corporations, not just in this region, by the way. You're talking about this region being probably behind others, but honestly, I can tell in Europe is more or less is the same thing. It's not easy. So I would say the job to be done there is to really have programs that really have partners that are there in the journey. It's a journey. So startups need help to understand how to work with a corporate. So how to navigate a corporate, for example, a due diligence first. you as a founder did your homework to understand who the key stakeholders are, because in an enterprise, it's not straightforward, it's difficult, it requires time. Did you do that? Did you navigate the procurement? So do you know how to sell into enterprise? Do you know how to go to market enterprise? So these are things that we can help startup with, because they, most of the times, they don't know. But at the same time, on the other side, dear corporate, do you have the right governance in place to work with the startup, the commitment? Who is leading this? Is the C-level, the CEO involved in this? Is there is buy-in and support? So, you know, it's something that needs to be done ahead of time, because otherwise the reality is what you say is the procurement, is the operational
stuff. Communication will start to happen more easily.
100%. In fact, for example, in elsewhere in France, we launched a program called AI Factory. And it's a program where basically quarterly, we decided to pick up one industry and one corporate working with Microsoft in that industry to work with them to surface some of the challenges that they have, and then select startups in our global portfolio to work towards a POC or a solution for 3 months where we were hands-on to help them build that product or that POC. So we did it in green energy, healthcare, we did it for agri-food with Danone, and then we are doing the currently mobility and financial services.
Is this a specific program? Or?
It's a specific program. So it was launched in France, so it's not global now. It's not global now, it's done. But with the accelerator we're launching, we are kind of replicating some of those learnings in a linear way, if you want, to do that. And that's why I told before, our accelerator will have that focus of corporate angle and corporate engagement, because we will help corporate surface some challenges and connect. The thing is also real is that startups do not have time. So for me, the other thing is that these POCs should not be for free. And that's also an education to corporates. When we look at bridging this gap, is there should be an investment there and a commitment on both sides. Mm. Because we cannot ask founders that are already risking a lot in an environment where the ecosystem is not really as evolved as other places in the world, just to spend 3-4 months of their time with, you know, for free and without a source. So for me, POCs, when we talk about this relationship corporate startups, there a lot needs to be done with corporates and CEOs and their C-levels to open a conversation on how it could be done better and in a more meaningful way.
I think we'd love to know more about this program, because sure. I think it's important. I want to say, you know, we are lucky here in the UAE, because UAE, as I said earlier, is the hub for most of the regional headquarters for multinationals. So the like of Microsoft and others, they are all based here. And most of them, they run their regional businesses out of here. So that's a big advantage really for startups here, because you have access to those companies and people. So the program that they design is really you can access, and most of, if I'm not mistaken, most of the activities and the events happens here. So really you have a big advantage. Others, they travel and, you know, they communicate from distance. But for us here, we have a really big advantage. And I think this is great. I think I would have to conclude this now, but I think we are in the UAE about to come with the next 50 years strategy. The government already announced some elements of these strategies. I think more strategies will come. I'm talking about the federal government, for innovation, for SME support, for entrepreneurship, and I think the timing is great. But as my colleagues here suggested, starting a business is not an easy ride. And to do a business, you have to get your hand dirty, and you have to really spend time, educate yourself, build relationship, solve problems. You can solve problems, or in a country like us, I always say, leverage your opportunities, because we are a young, rich country in a region that has a lot of wealth, and there are so much opportunities. You know, people in old continents, they have problems. Here, most of the time, we have really opportunities that we can leverage. So I think that's a big chance for everyone. Like I said, you have to be part of an ecosystem.
And that's what we are trying to create here. I always tell my team that the type of ecosystem we are creating here is probably, I don't think it's ever been produced in the Middle East. And this is, we cannot do it without the right partners. And you guys are also part of our ecosystem. So with this, I really like to take the opportunity to thank you for your time today. I know this is a big topic. We cannot finish it in one hour, but this is just a start. We are working, hopefully, with Microsoft, we are working with Freya and others to develop different programs to address different challenges. I believe that we have an SRT IP in terms of resources, in terms of capabilities. Probably you saw some of the capabilities we have this, whether it's the Sharjah Open Innovation Lab or even the lands we have, or the big projects we have here with transport and logistics, agriculture technologies, 3D, and artificial intelligence, and VR, AR. I think this is all at your disposal. I love our community here. We have almost now 100 companies. Trust me, a big part of them are all stars. And I'm very proud of Freya looking at me, and she's one of the stars, okay? But we really have very good people here. So with this, I really would like to thank you for being with us this evening. And I look forward to also welcome you in our next events. This month, we have a very busy month. We will soon have our Women in Technology conference. It will be a hybrid conference on the 23rd and 24th of this month. We will also have on the 15th of this month an exhibition here for smart cities technologies. And in addition to the event. So this place is buzzing, and please do attend our events, and also you can invite your friends, and look forward to seeing you. Thank you very much. And thank you for your time today.
Thank you. Thanks.